in environments where surveillance, coercion, or seizure are actually real threats, standard encryption alone leaves you exposed. You could argue it keeps your data confidential. What happens when someone puts a gun to your head and basically asks for the key that way? Or when a judge threatens you with contempt charges. If the adversary knows you're using encryption and like you can't explain away the encrypted material, you're pretty much done, right? So that's where deniable encryption actually comes in. The art of hiding secrets so well that you can convincingly claim that they never actually existed. Deniable encryption is a class of cryptographic techniques that allow users to encrypt data in such a way that the existence of certain information can be basically denied under direct scrutiny. And the goal extends far beyond keeping unauthorized users out. Like, if you want to make it impossible to prove additional undeclared data exists at all. The concept emerged in the early 1990s when researchers began exploring ways to actually protect users against rubber hose cryptanalysis, the kind of charming practice of beating encrypted keys out of people with actual rubber hoses. Like in 1997, Ross Anderson and Roger Needham and Andy Scheimer, sorry if I mispronounced your name, formally introduced the idea in their paper, the steganographic file system. Their system proposed a method where multiple encrypted files could coexist on the same physical security with different passwords, unlocking different layers of data, if that makes sense. Simple, but really powerful. If someone forces you to unlock your actual encrypted files, you reveal only the decoy volume and convincingly deny that anything else exists. The model was later implemented in tools like TrueCrypt and its successor, which is VeraCrypt, which introduced the hidden volume feature. The user creates an encrypted container within another encrypted container, each with different passphrases. One password reveals your tax returns, let's say, and cat photos, and that's the decoy. Another reveals your XMR wallet, Bitcoin wallet keys, or whatever else that you'd rather keep private. Crucially, the existence of the second volume remains completely undetectable. Even advanced forensics can't really distinguish between unused disk space and hidden data. And there are two main types of deniable encryption that actually exist. There's storage-based deniability, which is physical or logical structures like disk volumes, for example, that contain multiple layers of encrypted data without actually revealing that more than one actually exists. Examples include VeraCrypt's hidden volumes or graphic file systems like Julian Assange's old rubber hose project from 1997. Though that one's dead, we come to communication-based deniability. And here, users can plausibly deny sending, receiving, or possessing certain messages. Secure messaging protocols like Off the Record, which is now outdated, or Signal's double ratchet algorithm also ensure that conversation transcripts can't be cryptographically authenticated after the fact, preserving things like plausible deniability. Picture carrying a locked briefcase, a traditional encryption gives you a single key and forces you to open it, and everything's exposed once that happens. Deniable encryption, however, creates multiple secret compartments inside and like each accessible with a different key, more or less. Under coercion, you open one with the boring documents, no evidence exists of the actual other compartments. In high-risk environments, this becomes rather essential because of obvious reasons, right? Like, so we'll take Ross Ulbricht, for example. Now, when the FBI actually grabbed his laptop in that San Francisco library, they caught him logged in and it was game over. But imagine if he'd used proper deniable encryption with a duress password that wiped the real data while actually displaying a decoy. journalists in authoritarian regimes, dissidents and whistleblowers, or anyone operating in legally gray areas, needs systems where sensitive material, the existence of that kind of stuff, actually remains cryptographically deniable. If an adversary can't actually prove the protected data exists, coercion loses its teeth. Deniable encryption demands careful execution. Success absolutely depends on plausibility of how believable your decoy actually appears. An empty volume or one filled with obvious generated junk raises some red flags faster than a custom agent finding a kilo of white powder in your luggage. And if your device shows 500 gigabytes used, but your actual decoy volume contains, say, 3 Word documents, investigators are going to piece together that there's an issue. Effective deniable encryption requires chaff files, so to speak. There's staged documents, and it's time-consuming kind of metadata to try to sell the illusion. Forensic memory analysis poses another threat. Sees a device while powered on and RAM dumps may expose encryption keys, usage logs, or signs of hidden containers. Chelsea Manning, for example, learned this the hard way. Investigators recovered chat logs from RAM even after deletion. Proper operational use demands hold shutdown protocols and amnesic systems like Tails, which clear RAM on power loss. Then there's the whole legal minefield, and some jurisdictions make refusing to decrypt data a crime in itself. And the UK's REPO, or Regulation of Investigatory Powers Act, can actually land you in prison for up to 5 years just for staying silent about your passwords. And in 2007, a British citizen got 14 months for actually refusing to decrypt his device at the border. Now, the United States has the Fifth Amendment, but courts increasingly find kind of creative ways to try to circumvent it and get around it. Biometric locks, for example, are not testimonial, so no Fifth Amendment protection actually exists. Deniable encryption offers a solution for this. Comply with demands while also protecting what actually matters. File systems betray you in a ton of different ways. So swap files, indexing services, thumbnail caches, like recent file lists, all leave breadcrumbs of some kind, pointing to hidden activity. Windows helpfully creates shadow copies of files that you thought you actually deleted. Mac OS indexes everything from spotlight search that actually happens. So even accessing a file on a hidden drive might leave traces in system logs. Deniable encryption must pair with full device operational security. So stuff like secure bootloaders and journaling suppression and encrypted swap or no hibernation and minimal or ephemeral host systems, right? Real world example is in 2020, German police raided a darknet vendor's home and they found VeraCrypt volumes, but couldn't actually prove hidden volumes existed. And the vendor provided the outer volume password, revealing cryptocurrency trading records. And plausible for someone like him, interested in things like privacy. The hidden volume with the vendor's data remained undetected and he walked eventually, right? So ultimately, deniable encryption provides control over what your adversary can actually prove exists, and not just who can actually access it. It adds uncertainty to the surveillance equation, making it almost impossible to know if the entire truth has actually been extracted. And that uncertainty protects the operator. So a good thing to do is to ask yourself, like, if law enforcement kicked in your door right now, could you provide access to a decoy that would stand up to scrutiny, right? Could you hide what actually matters while leaving zero evidence it ever even existed? Because relying on encryption alone is kind of like bringing a knife to a drone strike. Like, technically you're armed, but you're still kind of screwed, right? Thank you for watching to the end. And as always, I'll see you in the next video.